worship. I'm inviting you to stand up with me and so that we can get our worship service started today. It's a song, Every Move I Make. We did it last week. It's an awesome video, and all you have to do is follow the shadow person for the movements. Are you guys ready? All right, let's get this started. Time to play our game, and it's called Would You Rather. What you're going to do is you're going to follow the narrator on the screen, but basically you're going to have one of two choices, and you've got to choose which you would rather do. Are you guys ready to play? I can't hear you. Are you ready to play? That's great. Let's get started.
What would you rather have? We asked 100 kids to choose between two things. Let's see if you can guess what they chose. If you think more kids picked the first choice, you'll stand up. If you think they went with the second, then you'll sit down. But don't lean back in your chair because, well, you know. A new bicycle or a new electric guitar? What do you think most kids chose? Stand up for the bike, sit down for the guitar. Percent of kids said they would rather rock out. 1 limousine or an airplane? What would you rather have? Stand up for the limousine, sit down for the airplane. 68% of kids said they would rather have the airplane. $1 million or 1 million kisses from my Aunt Bertha. Stand up for the money, sit down for the kisses. ~99% of kids said they'd rather take the cash. A hamburger or pizza? What would you choose? Stand up for the burger, sit down for the pizza. ~52% of kids said they'd rather have pizza. A baby kitten or a little baby puppy? Stand up for the kitten, sit down for the puppy. 60% of kids said they'd much rather have a puppy. Thanks for playing What Would You Rather Have? Till next time.
Hey, all you wonderful families, thanks for joining us. Hey, did you have fun choosing What Would You Rather Have in our game today? Yeah, felt sorry for Aunt Bertha. Only 1% wanted her kisses. Bummer. But hey, I get it. $1 million is a lot of money, right? Well, speaking of money, in today's story, we're going to hear about a man who wanted money from two of Jesus' followers. But instead of giving him money, they gave him something far more valuable. Now, before we go into that cool story, let's do a quick recap. All right, first, we learned that at Pentecost, God sent his Holy Spirit to the believers. And also, God gave them just what they needed to start the mission Jesus had given them to tell the world all about him. And that was the gift of the Holy Spirit, right? And God's Holy Spirit also gave Peter the ability to speak to the crowd that had gathered at Pentecost. Now, do you remember how many people came to believe in Jesus that day? If you know that number, just shout it out. Let me hear you. That's right. 3,000. 3,000 people came to believe in Jesus Christ that day. And every day, more and more people came to know Jesus and joining the believers. Now, the sad thing is this, is that the more the disciples talked about Jesus, the more life became difficult, really difficult for them. And there were people who did not like anyone talking about Jesus. So let's go into our story now and see how the follower of Jesus responded to this and what they gave that certain man who was in need. So let's check it out.
The Bible, it's 66 books of history, stories, letters, and poetry that fit together to form God's one big story. The epic adventure of how he created us and loves us so much that he made a way to rescue us. As we travel through the Bible, from Genesis to Revelation, we discover people who met God and found their lives changed forever. And now for an amazing story, inspired by the book of Acts, chapters 3 and 4.
John found himself nearly skipping as he and Peter made their way up toward the temple.
More than 3,000. More than 3,000 people are following Jesus now.
I've never seen anything like it. The way people are sharing their homes, their food.
Every day a few more people believe.
This tell the whole world gig is going more smoothly than I expected.
As Peter and John approached the temple gate, they saw a man lying on a mat.
Please, help me.
We'll call the man Ezra. For his entire life, he'd been unable to walk a single step.
Could I have a few coins for food?
Peter and John looked directly at the man. Peter could feel the power of God's Spirit rising inside him.
Look at us.
Ezra fixed his gaze at the disciples and held out his hand.
I don't have silver or gold, but I'll give you what I do have. In the name of Jesus, get up and walk.
Peter reached out and took Ezra's hand. Instantly, his feet became strong. He leapt to his feet.
Wait, what? How?
He took a step, a skip, a hop, and a jump.
Praise Jesus!
Ezra began to dance and spin around.
This guy couldn't even walk 10 minutes ago!
And as you might guess, a big crowd gathered. Peter called out loudly.
Fellow Israelites, why does this surprise you? It's not as if we've made this man walk by our own power or godliness. God has done this. God has brought glory to Jesus who serves him. This man, whom you see and know, was made strong because of faith in Jesus' name. Faith in Jesus has healed him completely.
Wowzers!
So turn away from your sins and turn to God. Then your sins will be wiped away.
But while the crowd was wowed, the religious leaders were fuming. They sent the captain of the temple guard to arrest Peter and John and sent them to prison.
Preach it to the rats, boys!
What's that you said about things going smoothly?
God's Holy Spirit is still with us, even here.
The next day, a group of religious leaders, including the high priest Annas and his family, gathered together. They ordered the guards to bring Peter and John before them.
By what power did you do this?
And through whose name?
Peter didn't hesitate.
Rulers and elders, do you want to know why we were kind to a man who couldn't walk? Are you asking how he was healed?
Peter gestured to where Ezra was standing, not far off, watching. Ezra did a little two-step. The religious leaders glared.
You nailed Jesus Christ of Nazareth to the cross, but God raised him from the dead. It is through Jesus' name that this man stands healed. You can't be saved by believing in anyone else.
If mics had been invented, Peter would have dropped one right there. The leaders glowered, and Annas cleared his throat.
Leave now, and never come back. Until we call for you.
Once Peter and John had been taken out, the leaders grumbled to each other.
The nerve. These are common men.
With no training. So bold. I hate to say it, but...
Say what?
Well, the way they talk. You can tell they've been with Jesus.
But what can we do with them?
Everyone in Jerusalem knows they performed a miracle. We can't say it didn't happen.
This stops here. It stops now.
We give them a warning. Never speak to anyone in Jesus' name again.
Ah, yes, that's it.
Peter and John were brought to stand before the religious leaders again.
You must never speak to anyone in Jesus' name again.
Yes, or else.
Peter and John exchanged a glance. They knew these leaders had the power to lock them up, or even kill them.
Which is right from God's point of view? Should we listen to you?
Or should we listen to God? You be the judges.
There's nothing else we can do.
We have to speak about the things we've seen and heard.
Just don't do it!
The leaders couldn't find any reason to keep Peter and John in prison. So, they finally let them go.
Yes! Exploding fist bumps, my bros!
Peter and John returned to their friends and shared everything God had done. Through the power of God's Spirit, the number of believers had now grown to more than 5,000.
How cool was that? Now, did you catch on what the man who couldn't walk received? What did Peter offer to the man instead of silver and gold? If you know, just shout out his name. That's right, Jesus. They told the man all about Jesus, who is the Savior of the world, the forgiver of his sins. And lots of people who had seen the man healed and heard Peter's message became believers as well and put their faith in Jesus Christ. And the number of believers that day grew to about 5,000. Yeah. And Peter and John, they showed determination even when they were thrown into jail and put on trial. Peter and John were great examples of determination. And also our bottom line for today, they lived it out without even knowing it. And let's read it together. Here we go. Keep going even when it gets tough. Also, let's review our memory verse for this month as well. Here we go. Let's not become tired of doing good. At the right time, we will gather a crop if we don't give up. Galatians 6:9. So remember, when life gets tough, we can have determination just like Peter and John did. And we can rely on God and ask Him to give us the strength we need to keep going. Why? Because God is with us and He has given us everything we need to keep going. Let's go ahead and pray. Lord, we thank You for giving us everything we need, Lord, to keep going even when things get tough. God, I thank You for sending Your Son Jesus, the Savior of the world. I thank You, God, for sending the Holy Spirit that gives us the power and the strength to keep going when things get difficult, when life gets difficult. That, Lord, You are there and You carry us, Lord, and we thank You for that. Lord, help us to keep going when things get tough. Help us to put our trust in You every day more and more. We thank You, Jesus, for being our King, and we pray this in Your mighty name. And the family say, amen. All right, thank you, my friends, for being here, and God bless. Take care.
Well, hello again, kids. We are now going to get ready for our final worship song. But one thing, you guys learned today that when things get tough, which things are kind of a little tough right now, God is always the one who will bring us back up, which ties into our song today. You remember last week, get down? So when we're down, who is it that lifts us up? God lifts us up. So why don't you guys all stand up and join me, and let's do this amazing worship song together called Get Down.
Oh! back down. No matter what stands against us, we know our God is stronger. This life is like a race we're meant to run, and no matter what we face, you overcome. And even when there's mountains in our way, we'll trust in you, 'cause you alone will be our strength. We won't give in or give out, we won't give up or back down. No matter what stands against us, we know we won't lose heart or lose hope. Our God is in control. No matter what stands against us, we know our God is stronger. And when it seems the mountain is too high, we'll still believe, 'cause you are on our side. Even when we're tired and we feel like giving up, we know we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. We won't give in or give out, we won't give up or back down. No matter what stands against us, we know we won't lose heart or lose hope. Our God is in control. No matter what stands against us, we know our God is stronger. Greater is He who is on our side, on our side. Greater is He who is on our side than anything that stands against us. Greater is He who is on our side, on our side. Greater is He who is on our side than anything that stands against us. We won't give in or give out, we won't give up or back down. No matter what stands against us, we know